Yes, sir.
Agnes?
Yes, sir, you can start now.
Okay, I will share the screen. Please bear with me because we have not been using Zoom. It's banned here. We have been using only Microsoft Teams or Cisco. So I'm having little trouble with, let me see how to come out of it. Is the screen visible? Can you hear me, Agnes?
Yes, sir.
So is the screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'll go to slideshow mode. Okay, I suppose this also is visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so 1 hour I have, right? Or less? Okay, I think there is no response. So, NR, can you hear me?
Clear, loud and clear, as well as your slides.
Okay.
Perfect.
So here we go. The topic is design of underwater vehicles and overview. So I will not be going into too much of naval architectural aspects or technical aspects like hydrodynamics or structural mechanics of vehicles. It is a broader view of the whole underwater domain. As far from a naval architect's point of view, of course. So my credentials, I have been in this business ever since I joined Navy. Specifically, I worked in the ATP program for about 20 years in various departments of submarine design, construction, overseeing, program management, etc. So presently I'm in L&T Defense Submarines and Underwater Platforms, BU. We have a submarine design and an engineering center. So we do, of course, we are the main partner for the Indian Navy for building these nuclear submarines. We also do other underwater crafts, underwater platforms. So let's go further. So as I said, broad scope of this presentation is generally about underwater vehicles. What are the specific aspects of design, design problem, design process, design challenges, and also a little bit about the design enterprise as such, how to manage this complex enterprise of designing a thing like nuclear submarine, for example. So underwater vehicles has certain specific characteristics as compared to other marine vessels. They operate in three-dimensional hydrospace, primarily submerged, but also operate on surface as required. They need to have a pressure-resistant chamber to house people if it's a manned vehicle, and waterproof equipment. So this puts a limitation on the maximum depth to which it can dive. And it has to be neutrally buoyant when fully submerged. Unlike a surface vessel, this is a huge challenge to maintain the weight and buoyancy balance at all times. It relies on sound for navigation, communication, and detection for a military vehicle, that is, while submerged, because electromagnetic waves cannot penetrate deep underwater. And the duration of continuous submerged operation, or the submerged endurance, we call it, is limited by two factors. One is the availability of air-independent sources of energy, primarily in the form of electrical energy, and human endurance. So this graph shows the distribution of ocean area vis-a-vis the depth of the ocean. As you will see, most of the area, about 10, okay, 10, less than 10% of the area is about 300 meters and below. This is mostly the continental shelf. But here is where maximum human activity happens. Most of the vessels operate. Of course, then the other end is we have these trenches like Mariane Trench, which is the deepest part of the ocean, 11 kilometers approximately. And most of the ocean floor is in the range of 3 to 6 kilometers deep. Only our National Institute of Technology, who operates, who undertakes scientific and other industrial activities in these depths. And if you take the cross section, you see that, by the way, this top thing is visible there. Is it obstructing part of the screen?
It's actually visible.
No, sir, it's visible.
I don't know whether I have to remove this. It used to be in the down.
But it is visible, sir.
Visible?
Yes, it's visible.
Hide video panel? No. Meeting internet.
Everything is okay.
I'm not able to hear it properly.
We can see your screen properly. Fine. Your screen is fine. So please continue.
Okay. So this slide, but this shows a variety of vehicles. And there is a limited depth to which man can dive or human beings can dive without much aid. And beyond certain depths, you need more and more of technology to reach far and deeper and deeper. And this is the Trieste, the first time human beings went down up to this close to 11 kilometers by Jacques Picard, I think, and John Walsh in 1960 or 62. After that, two other people went there. As far as the kinds of underwater vehicles are concerned, we have on the extreme end of the spectrum, we have these large submarines or military submarines. They are either nuclear propelled or conventional, which is primarily diesel electric. Then in the mid-range, we have midgets and mini submarines that is about say less than 1,000 tons displacement, 100 to 1,000 tons displacement. We have swimmer delivery vehicles and chariots. These are used by the SEALs or the so-called marine commandos. We also have in with the Indian Navy these chariots. Submersible comes in various hues and varieties, mostly for industrial and commercial applications, also for recreational applications. Then we have nowadays a lot of proliferation of autonomous underwater vehicles and remotely operated vehicles for various applications. Military also is using more and more of this nowadays. As far as types are concerned, we can broadly divide them into manned and unmanned or autonomous or remotely operated. In terms of roles, there can be military submarines or for scientific purposes, commercial recreation. So if you take the roles, these are military roles for warfare, for land attack, for special operations, that is for landing or deploying and recovering the commandos from underwater. ISR roles, mine laying, mine hunting roles, search and rescue transportation. Similarly, for commercial, in the oil and gas industry, a lot of applications are there. Similarly, for undersea cables, the submarine cables, laying as well as its repair, etc. For tourism, as well as high-end luxury recreational crafts and scientific. So starting with the big ones, submarines, this is the typical military submarines. They have, the payload is basically weapons and sensors. Weapons means either they are torpedoes, which are fired in the horizontal direction, and the vertical launched missiles here, VLMs. They can be intercontinental ballistic missiles or cruise missiles for land attack. Tube launched missiles. Nowadays, missiles have been designed to be fired from the torpedo tubes themselves, but of course of limited range. Mines And swimmer delivery vehicles also are carried, like you can see one here mounted on top of this submarine. And this shows the submarines of the world. These are the big ones, the strategic submarines or ballistic missile submarines, also called SSBNs. This is the Typhoon, the biggest of them with the Russians, some 25,000 ton, 28,000 tons displacement. Ohio class, the big one. The Americans, the Buroi, the latest from the Russians. Vanguard is the British. Delta, Triumphant French, this Chinese. Then we have nuclear-powered guided missile submarines. Then we have nuclear-powered attack submarines. Then the attack submarines were with air-independent propulsion systems, and the rest are the diesel-electric submarines, which are otherwise called the conventional submarines. And these are the ballistic missiles, or SSBNs, owned by and owned and operated by the big five: America, Russia, China, Britain, and France. We have also got into this club recently with our commissioning of Arihant. It is rumored that the North Koreans also have converted one of their diesel submarines to carry some strategic missiles, but it's not authenticated or verified. In the Asia Pacific, we have Russians, Chinese, primarily the biggest threat for us. And many other Southeast Asian countries do have small number of submarines in their navy. This is a typical midget. This is a South Korean design, 500 tons displacement. This is a special operations vehicle, again, a midget which we have been developing. This is in an advanced stage of design, which can carry the swimmer delivery vehicles on its sides, and primarily meant for deploying special operations forces. Minis comes. This is a typical submarine, about 100 tons displacement. From Ocean Submarines of Netherlands. It is not a coincidence that it looks like an aircraft, because this person who designed it was an aircraft designer. So, but there is different variants, the tourist variant, luxury variant, then offshore application with the manipulator and all that, Coast Guard and Navy applications. Swimmer delivery vehicles, they are carried on board the big submarines, and they are sort of wet submarines, means they are not pressure resistant. The swimmers, the SEALs or the marine commandos, they're exposed to the external water pressure. So it is, the submarine takes the swimmer delivery vehicles to nearer to that coast, and then after that it is deployed. This is autonomous underwater vehicles, typical for a recreational purpose or a scientific exploration. Unmanned underwater vehicles has become very common now. More and more for military applications, they are used also in the form of underwater drones for intelligence gathering, as well as for weaponized applications. This is the biggest of unmanned underwater vehicle, which we know this is extra large unmanned underwater vehicle designed by the company Boeing for the American Navy. It carries a lot of payload, modularized payload. It shows one of those this is about 100 kg, removes 600 UUV. Submersibles, mostly for commercial industrial applications, as well as for scientific purposes, oil exploration, etc., undersea mining. And for tourism applications across the world, there are tourist submarines operating. Nearest to us is Maldives have got this whale submarine. There is one in Mauritius, Seychelles, Indonesia, in the West Europe, Mediterranean, and American coast. So now coming to design challenges, these are unique to each class of submarines, which I mentioned. So if you take nuclear submarines, the biggest challenge is safety, health, and environment because of the nuclear radiation and the reactor. And since they are supposed to operate underwater for long duration of, say, months, so human endurance is a big parameter to be considered while designing. Because it is not only the food or the air or what is important, energy is almost unlimited, but people will have psychological issues if it is not handled properly. Conventional submarines, they are limited by the power generation and storage capacity, primarily power generation using the diesel generator and fuel carried, and storage in batteries. So they impact design the most. And since the maximum underwater endurance for a diesel electric submarine is about 20, 21 hours, so 3 hours in a day they have to surface for charging their batteries. So that is called indiscretion rate. 3/24 is the indiscretion rate, about 10 to 15% is the range. And with the air independent propulsion systems, which are based on fuel cells technology and other types, the conventional submarines are given some capabilities that a nuclear submarine has, because it can remain submerged for maybe a week or more. Midget and mini submarines are constrained by space, naturally, because they are smaller in size and they need to have customized equipment for fitting inside small space. Deep submergence vehicles are weight driven, because as you go more and more deep, the pressure hull becomes more and more heavier, the thickness and the scantlings of the pressure ring frames, etc. So weight becomes an issue. And of course, some of the items which are exposed to external pressure will also have to be hardened for that purpose. Similarly, for remotely operated vehicles, naturally how to handle this umbilical cord, which supplies so many, including electrical power and signals to and fro. Autonomous underwater autonomous unmanned vehicles, energy storage is a limitation. And of course, the control algorithm and communication is a challenge. As far as specifically for military submarines, typically they are high value platforms engineered to order, unlike aircrafts or automobiles or battle tanks. They are ordered in limited numbers, say 6 or 12 max. And we cannot afford to have a prototype for testing. Again, unlike aircraft, you make a replica of the actual or the full 100, 1:1 scale for testing and proving before batch production. Very little room for error. This is typical of submarine, unlike any other vessel, because of space constraint and weight sensitivity. And any rework in a confined space is a huge cost. Systems are highly coupled and interdependent, and failure of any critical system, of course, not to talk about the pressure hull itself, but there are vital systems like seawater systems and other systems, can turn out to be catastrophic. So safety is of paramount importance. So no need to emphasize the requirement of exercising at most professional discipline by the designer, as well as during construction, operation, and maintenance of these complex systems. Whereas if you take the unmanned underwater vehicle, that is a smaller one, they are low value. Of course, they are also not made in large numbers, but we can make a prototype. Standard form means they are of regular shapes like cylinder, hemisphere, cone, and they are normally modularized in design. We can have the propulsion module or energy storage module, payload module. We can replace this module by module as per the requirement. Of course, failures are not leading to so much of any loss of life or material property. Yes, navigation and control is very critical. Yes, this is a general statement. This is applicable for any complex platform design. The but stated sometimes they just qualitative statement, not quantitative. Sometimes performance parameters are specified, sometimes specific features that should not be more than some value or the length or breadth or whatever it is. Now, just to take the task of an analyst versus a designer, I would say analysis is rather easier than designer's task, because analysts has got a known object. We need to predict its behavior or its properties, whereas design is the reverse problem, where we know what properties we need, but we do not know which object or what configuration will meet or give these properties. And once you have a design, then if you need to improve or change anything, any property, it will require some change in the configuration or the object, and it will lead to cascading changes in other properties. Because these systems are highly coupled and interdependent, especially for a submarine. So how do we go about the design? It starts with defining the roles and concept of operations, like what kind of role for a military submarine, anti-submarine warfare or land attack task or ISR or search and rescue, and some subtasks. And also the operational environment needs to be defined, like area for operations, temperature, salinity, humidity, sea state in which it is to operate, and whether it has to operate in shallow water. Then comes the definition of performance parameters. That is what payload, what speed, diving depth, range, endurance, complement. Complement means the crew, number of crew, underwater radiated noise, or this C4 ISTAR. So these, in the Navy, we call it SQRs, or staff qualitative requirements. For my younger colleagues who are in Cochin University, you must be knowing honors requirements as the input for your, for example, for doing your project or design project. So SQRs is like honors requirements. And based on that, the technical characteristics of the platform have to be determined, whether it's displacement, capacity of the batteries for storing electricity or engine power, etc. So first task is for the owner or owner's naval architect to determine what are the best combinations of this performance parameters, because that is a given to the design, to the designer as a contractor. It doesn't mean that the owner, to arrive at this, the owner also has to do some design studies. Maybe at a higher level, like operation research and systems analysis and all that, which is done by the naval staff, supported by the Navy's own design organization. Now, how do you determine this? How we arrive at this combination? So this is primarily based on the compact worthiness or battle worthiness of the vessel. Now, what it consists of? The compact worthiness consists of seaworthiness and the strike capability and defensive capabilities. Seaworthiness is common for any other marine vessel, like you already know, stability, unsinkability, structural strength, mobility, that is speed and other things, controllability. Seakeeping, not very much of a requirement for a submarine, but yes, at periscope depth, or say about 30 to 50 meters below the sea, and the rough sea can affect the depth keeping ability of the submarine when it is in a firing corridor, for example. Endurance, especially underwater endurance, also for long transit. Habitability, very important for a submerged vessel where there is an enclosed environment. Unlike, again, like a surface vessel which can have ventilation system which runs all the time, taking fresh air from outside and taking out the polluted air. But for a submarine, submerged condition, that is not possible. We have to remove carbon dioxide in the first place and regenerate oxygen. That is the biggest task. Operability, maintainability issues, reliability, repairability, crew preparedness. So this is what makes any vessel seaworthy. But for a military vessel, what decides or defines its capability in the offensive, if it is an attack submarine, strike power, its control and command control, communication and processing capabilities, weapon control systems, battle space awareness systems, including network-centric warfare, connecting up the satellite communication, strike maneuvers. These are all part of offensive capability. As far as defensive capability is concerned, stealth, that is the ability to remain undetected. That means your signatures, whether it is infrared signature or acoustic signature, magnetic signature, any other wake signature, should be within limits so that you cannot be detected from a certain distance by certain means. Electronic warfare and support measure capability, evasive maneuvering capability, close-in weapon system, fire resistance, shock resistance, survivability, rescue, escape capabilities. So these are the ones which will determine the performance parameters. Performance parameters like speed, diving depth, range, turning radius, these give right, these determine the compact capabilities, what I just mentioned, in different manner. For example, speed, that determines how fast you can reach from base to the operational area, how fast you can, or how can you have to keep up if you are in a shadowing or a all attack submarines of one country keep track of the other country's SSBN. So you have to keep pace with that. And diving depth determines stealth. The more deeper you can go, the more difficult it is to detect you. Range, endurance, time on task in far off areas of operations, turning radius, how fast you can maneuver to escape from an incoming torpedo, for example, or avoiding a collision with a underwater or a surface vessel. Quick diving and surfacing capability. If there is a air threat, immediately you have to dive. So how fast you can dive and gain depth, that is a capability. Reserve of buoyancy is an indication of surface unsinkability. And also if you have a damage underwater and flooding underwater, then you can use this to come up fast surface. Payload determines the kill probability and sustainability. And the technical characteristics determine this performance parameters, or these performance parameters which I just mentioned are impacted by the choice of various technical characteristics. This is what the designer has to do to determine the most optimum combination of characteristics, like the battery bank or high-speed diesel engines or high-power diesel engines for charging batteries. So each of this impact these parameters either positively or negatively. Means it is not always that in this case, if you have a large battery bank, your submerged endurance will be longer. You can remain submerged. You can operate submerged longer, but then it will impact on the weight, the size, the cost will go up. So this is the flip side. So everything has got a positive side and a negative side. This is the challenge. Every time when you try to improve upon something, something else will degrade. So that is the challenge a submarine designer has. This is same in general for any complex platform. Also important is to take into account the buildability, procurability. See, a lot of items are not manufactured in-house, especially equipment. They are many times bought off the shelf to the extent possible, military off-the-shelf items. But some, of course, have to be developed or customized. So whether these technologies are available in the country or even abroad, if it is available abroad, are they available? Because there are export restrictions for certain applications of certain countries. Supportability, long-term life cycle support, upgradability. All these platforms have got a life of, let's say, minimum 25 years, but we stretch it to up to 40 years usually. So, but you know that technology, gets obsolete, weapons, advanced weapons come, counter weapons come. So at some time, through the midlife, there has to be a major overall replacement of a lot of things. So that designer should take into account that aspect also. Okay, and cost, of course, nowadays the defense budgets are becoming more and more difficult to get. So whatever money you have to use it the best possible manner. So we discussed this. So you know that like any ship, submarine design also is a iterative process. There is no closed form solution where you put in all the requirements and you get a solution as a output. So we have to go in a spiral, as you know, and you have to start somewhere. So that is called initial sizing. Initial sizing means primarily like logically for any thing what you design, you have to know how big it is, how heavy it is. Displacement for a marine vessel is the most characteristic, most important characteristic, which impacts on all aspects, float, move, fight, capabilities, as well as the cost. Now, to start with, it should satisfy Archimedes' principle, that is the weight of the vessel should be equal to weight of the displaced water. This should be true when it is floating on the surface as well as when it is submerged. And also space balance, this constant buoyant volume, that is when it is fully submerged, whatever the displaced water, that is the constant buoyant volume. That volume should be able to accommodate all the equipment systems, human beings, including the space for maintenance and passage, etc. What makes it even more challenging, unlike a surface ship, is that this has to match underwater, the weight and buoyancy has to be always matched. Unlike a surface ship, on the surface, if there is an addition of weight, it will just submerge a little bit, depending on the tons per centimeter immersion. It will submerge. It is not going to affect the performance of the vessel so much, like the speed or stability. It is not going to affect so much. But for a submarine, if it is lighter, means the weight is little less than the displaced volume, then it will not submerge. And conversely, if it is heavier, when it is fully submerged, if the weight is more than the buoyancy, then it cannot keep depth. So it will go down to the bottom of the sea. So this is the biggest challenge for a submarine designer. And the weights and volumes are determined by various functional groups. I will talk about a little later. So allocation of weight and volume as per requirements of the systems is another challenge. So this is done as usual based on past data, statistics, or type ship. Now, talking about displacement, for a submarine, there are different displacements defined. One, of course, is the standard displacement. This is a legal definition. But most often used is the normal displacement. This is the weight of the submarine, actually, when it is trimmed, means when it is floating in a neutral buoyant condition. Submerged displacement, this is the term used, which includes the normal displacement plus the volume of MBTs, main ballast tanks. And enveloped displacement or full displacement is the total displaced volume of the envelope of the outer shape of the submarine. So this is just for academic interest, but we will be, when we talk about displacement, normally we mean normal displacement. So let's see, initial design, there are, as I said, we can start like this. Weight is equal to weight of each item, or you know that weight of this vessel is a summation of weight of individual weights, say PI. And as per Archimedes, W should be equal to the buoyancy or the displaced weight of the displaced volume. And weight of most of the items, except the payload, depends in some way or other on the displacement. Let's put it like that, PI, I is any weight item or a system or a group, is a function of displacement. This relation can be a linear relation or a quadrilateral, square or whatever, it can be different. So we can write that the displacement will be equal to sum of all this, the unit weights, and part of it is a function of displacement itself, and rest is not dependent on displacement. So this is a implicit relationship. That is the problem we face, that we don't get a closed form solution to this equation. So this, if you expand, for example, it can be put like this. Displacement is a function of some part which is directly proportional to displacement, some weights which are proportional to displacement to the power of 2/3, means that it is proportional to the area, and some are not dependent. So this we can expand, it can be d raised to 4/3 like that. Similarly, we can set up an equation for volume. So total volume required is consisting of one part which is directly proportional to the volume itself, some part volume raised 2/3, and some constant volume. So with this, we can solve these two equations, the weight equation and the volume equations, simultaneously to get the solution to your displacement. Now, the crux of the thing is how you determine these coefficients. These coefficients, AB or AV, BV, which determine this nature of this function, how do you determine that? That is the main problem. So this is determined either using statistical data or using a type ship. Yeah. Except in the case of a totally revolutionary design. These are all evolutionary designs, but if you use a totally different concept, new architecture, new materials, new technology, which is not tried before, then we have to start from scratch. That you have to start with the preliminary arrangement. It just means that you have to do more iterations to arrive at a convergence. This is how this prototype transformation can be done. If you have the data of a prototype, the weight of individual items system-wise, or and we can determine the relations for the project using certain transformation or similarity theorem. I'm not going deep into it, but there are some scale factors we can arrive at. There are some computations required in this. I am not sure whether it is taught in QSAT, but this is followed. This is not anything unique. For this, you need to have a well-defined weight breakdown structure of the parent or the parent ship or the type ship. And this is the global division or the main groups. And each of this will have subgroups. Hull will have pressure hull, outer hull, casing, bridge fin, bulkheads, internal structures, foundation. Similarly, for each of these main group items, it can be broken down into different subgroups. So if you have such detailed breakdown of the weight for a parent ship, for our ship or the one which we are designing, then we can determine the scale factors using the similarity theorem. That I'm not going further deep into it. So you take this, proportionalities, how much of the total displacement is each of these for the prototype and for the project. So there will be, these ratios will be different because these weights depend on the performance parameters. So if one is a ship which is low endurance and you need a higher endurance, that means you need to have more ampere hour capacity of your batteries. Your battery becomes heavier and it takes more space inside. That will take more proportion of the weight and volume. So there is a way of determining this scale factors based on those ratios of the performance parameters. Okay, now we were talking about weight and volume. Basically, that weight volume balance is most essential, but it is not just, it's not sufficient enough. We need to have balance of power requirements or requirement versus supply or power demand versus supply. Cooling capacity, whether air cooled or water cooled, air regeneration, I mentioned oxygen regeneration, removal of impurities, and many other balances. So there is always a demand and there is always a supply. So we have to have a trade-off. All requirements cannot be met the way we want in the ideal situation. And this prototype transformation or statistical approach would give only an initial value of the displacement. And as we proceed further into the design, more and more constraints will start to be applied. And as the granularity of design increases, compatibility of requirements is essential. Though the staff qualitative requirement states certain requirements, usually it happens that staff wants all the best or whatever is available from the various other similar vessels. They will put all that, which obviously not always feasible or compatible. So we have to make certain compromises or trade-offs. So this is the designer's task to negotiate this with them based on our feasibility studies, whether you would like to have more of endurance or more of speed, more of stealth. So somewhere or other, you have to give and take. And optimization, any design is an optimization problem ultimately. Mathematically, we can put, for those who are more academically oriented, this design problem can be modeled mathematically like this. X is a vector of all these technical characteristics, what we talked about, that define the submarine. This is the design variables, independent design variables. And then there's certain parameters which are given, which also may be representing performance or the characteristics of submarine. As I mentioned, sometimes the customer says the displacement should be this, not more than this or less than this, whatever, or stability or speed. No, stability, speed is not, sorry. It should have, two compartments, three compartments, those kind of requirements. Then there is a set of relationship which define the constraints. These comes out of physical natural laws like Newton's laws, Archimedes' principle, inequalities, algorithms, etc., between the design variables and the parameters. And then we have to have an objective function, which is like a measure of merit, whether it's size, cost, safety, reliability, can be any aspect. So the task mathematically speaking, is to determine this vector, which the best combination, which meets all these constraints, what is given, such that this objective function is either minimum or maximum. If the cost is a cost, then it should be minimum. If effectiveness, it should be maximum or benefit. It's also important not that design variables to be limited to few that strongly influence parameters, because there is no end to it. So we have to limit the number of independent variables which we can handle in an optimization problem. Not all design variables will be continuous variables, like you cannot take a derivative if it is not continuous. So those issues are there. Okay, I'm not going further. So design process happens in this, generally in this manner: objective setting, gathering information, generating solution. This is the actual design, means the core task is generating solutions. Then you evaluate, that is analysis or validation. Then you choose based on some ranking, based on trade-off studies, etc., and then implement. So this is very familiar design spiral. We have normally at least this four phases. One is concept design, that is this outer one, concept design phase, then a preliminary design phase, then contract design phase, and then detailed design phase. So normally up to here, this is done by the staff branch, and then given to the shipyard for contract design and detailed design. So as you know, as we go more and more into the latter stages of design, the granularity and fidelity of this design increases. And each of this stage or phase of design gives a deliverable or an output, which we call, for a concept design, it may be called a technical proposal. And for a preliminary design, it may be preliminary build specifications. Or if it's a technical design, these terminologies I'll just mention. In fact, there are many terminologies, even in the military, different design bureaus or different nations use different terms. So it doesn't matter as long as you understand what it means. So sometimes called concept exploration and feasibility study stage. Preliminary design, Russians call it sketch design, or Western or British or American, they call feasibility design. Contract design, technical design is a Russian term. Contract is also called contract design, or generally called functional design, engineering design, design to build, detailed design. Detailed design, and this detailed design, obviously there is a confusion. So this means manufacturing drawings, so production drawings or workshop drawings. And at the end of each phase, there will be a gate to be passed where the design will be reviewed by the customer or customer's consultant, and before we pass to the next stage. And each stage, the quantum of work reflected as deliverables will also be different orders of magnitude. This table just brings out a comparative picture of the concept design and detailed design. I think, Akhil, how much time more we have?
Hello, sir.
Hello, how much more time we have?
Sir, actually, we intended the session to be of 1 hour and then 30 minutes for Q&A, sir.
So, when I'm supposed to finish?
Sir, the actual time was till 5:30. You can take 10 more minutes.
Okay, I'll skip all this because these are all details.
Sure.
These are all details. I think it will take more time. So ultimately, I've listed some of the deliverables of design process. You have to, this as-built drawings, of course, is after construction. Okay, this is deliverable document. This is actually at the end of construction. Just for young naval architects to understand that it is not just a few drawings and some project report. At the end, the huge amount of documentation also forms part of the delivery. When the ship is handed over to the customer, we have to hand over a lot of other things. These are some of them, as-built drawings, 3D model nowadays, all digital mock-ups and all that. Inspection reports, it's a huge amount of documentation, certificates, I-notes and things like that, tests and trials reports, exploitation documents, that means how to operate the systems, operate, it's also called operating and maintenance, operating instructions and maintenance. Technical manuals, repair technical documentation, that is when the ship goes for repair, what all needs to be referred. So these are also, why, what I wanted to say was, is the task of the designer. Ultimately, even after building the shipyard will compile all this and give it to the designer. Designer has to finally check and finally hand over. This is the typical timelines for a SSN design. This is for Virginia class, actually, the American nuclear powered attack submarine. Large numbers they have built. So about 1-2 years for concept design, about a year plus for preliminary design, similar time for contract design. Then detailed design starts, but normally construction starts somewhere in between. So say from start about within 7-8 years, they will start construction. So this goes concurrently. Modularity is difficult for submarines. This is okay, as I said, for unmanned underwater vehicles, which is more amenable to modular design. But for a space-constrained platform like a submarine, we cannot have much of modularity. There are advantages and disadvantages. Modularity requires or demands more space, weight, which is a premium for submarines. Okay, now a little bit about this management of this design enterprise. So the designer's objective is to deliver an engineering plan, primarily what the designer's output is a plan, whether you call drawings or specifications or documents, this is a plan of action, which will be followed by the execution agency, the shipyard. And also to provide necessary support, ensuring that the plan when executed would result in a quality ship. This is the responsibility of the designer, which would be safe and economical to build, operate, and sustain. Through deployment of right people, processes, and technology, and optimum utilization of available resources. So I tried to capture in a nutshell the core objective or the primary task of a designer. It doesn't end with some drawing or calculations. Holistically speaking, it goes much beyond. That means engineering support during construction, looking at all the aspects of maintenance, repair, in fact, ultimately disposal of this platform. Nowadays, that has become more and more critical. There are a lot of regulations, which some of you must be aware, even young people. And quality of design, when we say what it means, it is not just the functional performance. Of course, that is what the first thing, whether the mission capability, what was defined in the beginning, is met or not. Seagoing qualities or seaworthiness, that there is no compromise, of course, but it is more than that. Safety, the quality includes, in a generic sense, the safety of the platform, environmental sustainability, reliability, availability, maintainability aspects, detectability, vulnerability, susceptibility, survivability, buildability, workability. Workability means how easy it is to operate, or the ergonomics of the design. Not to talk about aesthetics, of course, habitability, supportability, durability, upgradability, ultimately economic viability. So for good quality design will lead to good quality engineering, will lead ultimately a good quality product. So there is a lot of onus on the designer. Though the cost of design or the efforts involved or the resources deployed for design may be 5% of the total cost of acquisition or ownership, but the impact it has down the line, downstream, is huge. Any compromise, any shortfall in design stage will have lasting impact, which affects the entire life cycle of the product. Now, what determines this quality? It is determined by the input, of course, and the feedback what you get. This is very important because you don't know everything. So many things are uncertain. Only when you actually operate the ship, you know what really happens. So the feedback from actual operation, that is a very useful input for the designer. Resources in terms of information, data, knowledge, design aids and tools like softwares, infrastructure, processes, various workflows. And nowadays, we all operate in a digital environment. We have 3D CAD tools and we have PLM softwares. We, of course, in L&T, we are totally paperless. We don't have any paper transaction in the design office, even in building. Workflow, information exchange, communication, and quality assurance. People, they are the most important determinant of quality. The knowledge, skills, and aptitude. And for submarine design, it is a huge challenge. You don't get people with, because this mostly comes from experience. Theoretical knowledge, what you gain from courses or your academic degree, that is one thing. But to be a consummate designer, it requires lots of experience of having designed and built and seen operating and getting the feedback, like you mentioned. That is what makes an expert designer. Technology, and oftentimes not recognized, but this management of this design enterprise, that is what I wanted to drive home. Young people, naval architects, your training, your course mostly was, technical, but it is unimaginable how much of data information is generated, handled, transacted, has to be stored and reused. There is a lot of issues which come up during design, further down during construction, resource allocation, project planning, monitoring and control, and ultimately vision, mission, commitment, values and culture of the organization. That also impacts how well you manage this design enterprise, because quality and of course on-time delivery, that is also equally important. Otherwise, it will go on for years. These kind of platform design, that it took total 25 years or so for the Arihant from design to commissioning, which is too long. Feedback I already mentioned. It comes from every stage. From designer, it goes to the owner, as I mentioned in the beginning. Based on the feasibility studies, et cetera, there is a need to revise the requirements themselves. And down the line, during construction, operation, and maintenance, all this feedback are very useful inputs, if not for this current platform, but for future, for or follow-on platforms or future designs. Safety, health, and comfort cannot be overemphasized for a submarine, which means watertight integrity, stability, strength, which is you all know. Survivability includes emergency surfacing, emergency supplies. You must have heard of incidents or accidents like Kursk and Komsomolets, which is, you know, something happened, some emergency happened, you have to survive. If not, you know, rescuing or salvage or saving the vessel, but at least the human beings. So it requires emergency supplies, emergency breathing air, emergency escape, means of escape, distress signaling for a search and rescue team to be attracted to where you are. Recently, there was the latest was a sinking of an Indonesian submarine in some 700 meters of water. All the people died. Very few cases where people were really rescued. Actually, there is only one recorded incident or a case where as people were rescued from a sunken submarine. Fire detection, firefighting systems, comfortable accommodation, microclimate control, amenities, aesthetic. This all affects the people. And if, you know, no, it's very difficult to imagine this claustrophobic living and operating in a closed, confined environment, not seeing the outside world or the horizon, and people can go mad. So a lot of importance is given to this, especially for the strategic submarines. There are reports and standards available for nowadays, most of the main classification societies have come out with rules for design of submersibles or submarines per se. Like Bureau Veritas rules for classification of naval submarines. This is DNVGL rules for submarines, Lloyd's. This is the Russian Maritime Register rules for submersibles, passenger submersibles. So just to sum up, so this management of design enterprise involves design quality management, safety management, project management, data information knowledge management, engineering support and change management, HR management, technology management, supply chain management, contract management. I'm not elaborating on this because of lack of time. Just to give an idea about the specializations required of the people or the designers and engineers who are involved. Broadly, they can be divided into designers and engineers. When we say engineers, they are the people who do all the analysis and calculations. Designers are those who do the actual creative part of, you know, generating solutions, which are, of course, there is a creative talent required, plus a lot of experience. Mostly it comes from experience. So we have various disciplines across the branches of engineering. And similarly for engineers and specialists. And this number of people in each category will depend, but say for concept design, I would say about maybe 100 to 300 people may be required to design some concept, to make a concept design. But as we go into detailed design, it may multiply to say 2,000, 3,000 people. And these are some of the established design houses or design bureaus across the world. In America, we have the Electric Boat, which designs their strategic submarine, BA Systems for UK, Naval Group for France, TKMS Germany, Navantia Spain, Saab Kockum Sweden, DSME, that is the Daewoo Shipbuilding and Marine Engineers, South Korea. Rubin is one of the design, they have more than one. Similarly, Italy, China, North Korea, Japan, they all have design bureaus, and also we L&T Defense in India. Summing up, design of underwater vehicles, submarines in particular, is an onerous task due to its complexity and unique requirements. Tolerance for error is very little, hence it requires at most discipline and tight control to be able to develop successful designs. It requires specialized resources, especially people with the right aptitude and specialized skills, knowledge, and experience. Availability of equipment and their binding data for platform design is a major challenge. Right management of design processes is as important as doing the technical tasks right. I have finished. Akhil, now, if there are any questions, I can try to answer them.
Yes, sir.
I'm not able to hear you. Hello.
I don't think, is there a provision for raising the hand in this? I can't see that.
I can hear you, sir, Mohanlal.
Sally, my question is not, I mean, I can make out that you have spent quite a lot of time and energy making this beautiful presentation. Thanks for that.
Thank you. Thank you.
I mean, especially for the younger generation, that will be quite helpful, getting an insight to the way you do it. My question is not technical, but what I look at is, if you look at the time frame, and it's a well-known fact that especially the naval designs or the defense designs takes extremely large time period to, even for the concept design and then later on the detailed design and the finally the product. Okay. So my question is that when you interact with the end users, the designer is separate and the end users are different. Like in, I'm in commercial building. For me, a small client comes with a simple proposal. I need a 2000 tonner tanker, nothing else. You decide which is best. As the level of the company increases, you know, where you have more people, some are knowledgeable, some pretend to be knowledgeable. You come up with sometimes, you know, unreasonable demands and things which are not logical. So either you put a firm foot down and say, that's not, this is what I'm going to give. There are some difficult customers who, but in your case, the end users is a different cup of tea. I mean, you have this. So do you normally face very unreasonable or difficult situations where you are not able to, as a professional, design the way you want?
No, let me tell you, though we are in the, we have a submarine design center.
Yeah.
And we have been partnering this, you know, ATV program from Arihant onwards. Mainly we were doing the construction so far. And lately, in the follow-on vessels, we have been associated with, we actually undertook the detailed design also. So far, all these vessels, basic design was done by the Navy's own submarine design group in Arkepuram, the Directorate of Naval Design, Submarine Design Group, Arkepuram. First time we have taken up our own in-house project was is this midget submarine, which I just flashed. You know, special ops vehicle. This is the first time we have done. So this is our own design. It has got a background, of course. Indian Navy had come out with the RFPs long back, first in 2009 and later in 2017. We were one of the contenders, but eventually it was withdrawn. Whatever reasons, it may come again, but it was withdrawn. So based on that time, we had tried to do some basic design and, you know, we even, I think we had some dialogue with some potential foreign collaborator for helping us, because we were a fledgling design organization. So, so there was no such customer for this. We are trying to sell it. In fact, the idea is to even market it to, you know, foreign navies, what we are doing now. So to be frank, in that respect, we didn't have such a situation where the customer was very demanding and we could not deliver as far as design is concerned. But yes, during construction, there was a lot of demands, though it was the design, basic design was of the Navy's, but during construction, a lot of issues were there. So I won't like to go into that because it's a classified project. So I don't know whether I've answered you, But more complex the platform is, more difficult this problem becomes, because the customer themselves do not know what they really want or what they can get. So exactly. to be on the safer side, to err on the safer side, they will put requirements. Chalo, ho gaya to theek hai, nahin to dekhenge. So they try to over specify. Then it becomes a task, negotiating and arguing with them that this is not feasible. You have this or that. Those kind of things come. I am talking about some other projects, which you are aware. So not really a submarine, but something else.
Yeah. Okay, thanks, Sally.
Before moving to the next question, I request everyone to check the chat box and please fill up the feedback form. Please feel free to ask questions now.
I have a question.
Sure.
Can I ask?
Yes, sir.
To NR and Rahim. NR, are you still there? No?
I think Rahim. Somebody has to unmute everybody.
I'm here, yes. Go ahead.
So, Rahim, was there anything of takeaway for you from this presentation? Just out of curiosity, I'm asking.
Yes, indeed, because the submarine design is a whole new spectrum for me, because so far I was familiar with the commercial ships only. So it was indeed very informative in that sense.
Something new?
Yes, something new, yes.
But NKK has got some submersible rules and all.
Yes, we have submersibles, but it was not general.
Class rules for submersibles?
Yeah, we have class rules for naval ships as well.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but Japan did not have permission to export the defense technology outside Japan until 3 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So we were not allowed to do any defense projects.
Okay.
But 3 years ago, Japan has liberalized, and then we released our rules, and we have built a number of ships for maybe the Australian Navy, for the Vietnamese and the Malaysian Navy.
Mm-hmm.
And we also did Shinkai 6500.
I've heard about that, yes.
At that time, that was one of the deepest. Those days, it could dive up to 6,500 meters. That is about 6.5 kilometers. So that
NIOT is now, they have come out with a tender for making that similar vessel. We are also one of those contenders.
Okay. So in that way, we were involved in the submersibles as well.
Mm. The government had come out recently with a deep sea policy, something like that, which has got such target set for designing such vessels, one of them.
Uh-huh.
Mandate given to NIOT.
Okay. I think, it is better India develop our own capabilities to design and produce such vessels.
Mm-hmm.
Especially when it goes to the depth of, say, more than 5,000 meters.
Yes.
And the technology involved and the material involved are somewhat different.
Thank you for the input. NR? Hello? NR is switched
off. I think NR got logged out. I can't see his name there now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, Akhil, who's...
Sir, there is some question in the chat box.
I didn't see it. Can you... should I see that?
Sir, I'll read. Can you please explain more how the reverse buoyancy work?
Reverse buoyancy. Who is the person who asked?
Dr. M. Ellen Govin.
Huh? How you go to the chat box? 8 minutes. Chat 7.
From the more option.
Yeah. Now I their feedback. There is an echo. Can you please explain more how the reverse buoyancy work? From Dr. Ilangovan. Dr. Ilangovan, are you still there?
Yes, sir. I can hear you, sir. Thank you for the wonderful presentation. And for me, it's almost a lot of information, totally new to me, actually. Once again, thank you.
Thank you. May I know where you are placed? Sir, which now, organization?
I'm in Veltech University, which is placed in Chennai. As a professor, I am there in the mechanical department.
Okay. Nice to have you here, but only I'm sorry, I did not fully understand the question because reverse buoyancy, I did not use that term.
Yes, sir. You're one of the slide, you are given some major, what is the initially conceptual design, that one of the title, that title word has come as reverse buyancy. So,
and I reverse, I meant reserve. Reserve like margin, like what you have up your sleeve, no? Reserve.
Reserved, okay.
Reserve buoyancy. That means, see, for a surface ship, whatever buoyant part of the ship exposed to air means not submerged, that is a reserve buoyancy, no? Means that it can submerge that much or it can take that much weight without completely foundering.
Reserve buoyancy, I understood, sir. Yes.
So similarly for a submarine, of course, that reserve buoyancy for a surface ship may be even more than the normal displacement, more than 100%. But for a submarine, it is never more than, say, 30%. There are two different types of, actually philosophy of design. The Russians submarines so far have been double hull submarines. Means there is a pressure hull and then enveloped by an outer hull. Outer hull is a thinner material. It is not designed to withstand the external pressure. But all these buoyancy tanks are located there, which is flooded for the submarine to dive. So there's a lot of space tankage available for ballasting. So they have reserve buoyancies of 30-32%. Western submarines reserve buoyancy is of the order of 10% only. They are all single hull submarines. Means the pressure hull itself is the outer hull, except the forward and aft and the above water region.
Okay, got it, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Most welcome. Carrie is posted very well presented PHMS. Thank you, Carrie. Are you still there?
Much very much here.
Oh, nice to hear your voice, buddy.
Great, Zali. I have a question which I have posted subsequently. Can
who's
you
speaking?
That?
Sorry, who's speaking?
Carrie.
And your voice, I broken. Suddenly thought. So.
Yeah.
Sadharana bolu samsarikku.
The problem is connectivity. I'm sitting in a place slightly out of civilization range.
Anyway, I would like to meet you up in person and chat with you.
But
tell me.
Yeah, the question was...
next one. L&D. Does L&D Defense have proposals for underwater vessels for transportation of commercial cargo? No. This Russians had actually... built underwater, submarine tankers during the World War time, and they primarily for military cargo or supplies. After that, nobody has built.
Okay.
Not a very good, solution or workable solution.
Okay. There was some news, especially in the, UAE, Gulf area, during this Iran-Iraq conflict, and even now that
I also heard, I think, yes.
Yeah, oil underwater and all that. So, of course, pipelines
are made. You're right. But my knowledge only as much as yours.
Okay, thanks, Ali.
Most welcome. Abhishek Kumar, reserve buoyancy. Okay, you have answered that question. Sorry, I had to repeat unnecessarily. Mohammed Sabiq, how do autonomous underwater vehicles work? Mohammed Sabih, are you there? Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
How autonomous underwater vehicle means it is not manned. No, it can be manned or unmanned, but normally unmanned.
I have heard about some unmanned underwater vehicles, drones.
Yes, just like aerial unmanned vehicle, there are underwater unmanned vehicles, drones, swarms. They are talking about swarms, a fleet or a flock of such things, small ones with a lot of intelligence built in. Nowadays, this is the domain of artificial intelligence, machine learning and all that. So they have their own computer sensors, local processing power. Yes, at times they are designed to come up and transmit it through satellite to the home base. But not on a continuous basis, because when it is fully submerged, the depth of, you know, the depth to which the electromagnetic waves can travel is limited. There can be other ways through underwater communication, like underwater telephones, and there are networks, underwater networks laid certain areas. So this way communication happens, but most of the time they have to do this autonomously, having certain intelligence built in for first to avoid obstacles and to discern whether it's an enemy or a friend, whether it's a merchant ship or a warship. Those kind of things has to be fed in, like signatures have to be fed in. So it is all not just left loose like that. It will be deployed after a lot of planning and based on a lot of intelligence data, information gathered by the operators. Then it is put on a specific mission. For example, go and attack Karachi Harbor, for example, I'm saying. So it is not just a free running amok kind of a thing. I don't have much more detail. Actually, there is another department in L&T Defense, which is specialized in this kind of products. We work together sometimes, but I don't have a deep understanding beyond this.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, it's mainly used in military services and all, right?
Say again?
Used in military services and all those military field, not in commercial field or anything.
Commercial field autonomous underwater vehicle can be used for hydrographic survey or search and rescue. It can be used. For example, an aircraft has been lost at sea. You know the last known location. Okay, but sea is so vast and so deep. How will you locate it for anybody to? So then only these things work. They will do a search and rescue operation. They will do in a pattern, well-defined pattern. So these things will be useful for those purposes.
So can you hear me?
Thank you, sir. Hello.
Most welcome.
So can you
hear me? We have finished the chat,
sir,
box.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
Sir, can you please comment on the impact of submarines and underwater vehicles on the marine environment, especially the hot spots like coral reefs and all the spots? Right? So can you please comment on that?
Yeah, there are more and more awareness about this impact of marine traffic on the marine life. That is a evolving field itself. In fact, one of our ex-naval colleagues, he started an institute in Pune, Maritime Research Center, and what is that called? That he studies especially what is the effect on this on the marine life, like shrimps and so many other things, including coral reef, of course. But if you're talking about submarines specifically, submarines are designed to be very quiet. That is their main requirements, being stealthy. Unlike commercial vessels, which need not worry about the acoustic signature.
Hello.
Yeah, hello. Can I continue? Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes.
So submarines are designed to be quiet in terms of hydrodynamic noise, because the flow around the submarine or the propeller cavitation or machinery noise, which comes from inside, airborne, structure-borne, waterborne noise. So that acoustic signature, first of all, is very small. Infrared signature also, it's all well contained. And of course, for a nuclear submarine, there may be more heat to be removed. Otherwise, it is not so much for other submarines. Then what else can impact the marine life? There is no, nowadays all paints and anti-fouling paints, everything is regulated by international organizations, or maritime organizations, etc. So such regulations and controls are there. So I don't think there is any such serious threat, especially from submarines.
Okay, then. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Thank you, sir. Due to our time limitations, we are concluding the Q&A session. For further queries, you may please contact Mr. PHM Sahay directly. Now, before concluding, we would like to present a certificate of gratitude to Mr. PHM Salik for honoring this event and delivering a wonderful talk.
Thank you so much, Agnes. Where is the certificate? Is it virtual or physical?
Virtual certificate.
Huh?
Virtual.
Virtual, oh, means verbal. Verbal certificate. Ah, talking of gratitude, right, on behalf of SNAS. Thank you so much. It was a pleasure, an honor, and a privilege to be talking to young naval architects of my alma mater. I hope I could do this more often in the future when I truly retire, perhaps. Thank you so much for patient listening. I hope this was of some value to the audience. Thank you, all my seniors, Mohanlal, NR, my friends, Carrie, Rahim, Professor Simon, and Dr. Who else is there? All distinguished audience, thank you so much.
Thank
Can
you,
we
sir.
Sign off now?
Talking of gratitude is that. I hope all have enjoyed the webinar. On behalf of SNAS, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Mr. PHM Salik for taking time from his valuable schedule and making this a very informative webinar on this special topic. My sincere gratitude to all members of DOSTAS from all over the world for the exceptional commitment to this department. On this occasion, I would like to thank our HOD, Dr. Madhyargan, for being a constant inspiration and for being with us in all activities conducted by SNAS. Last but not the least, I would like to thank every faculty and students who put a sincere effort to attend the webinar and make it a grand success. And always feel free to contact us for the feedback. It's highly appreciated. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Agnes.
Thank
bye
you
bye all.
Right.
Professor Madhyargan, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Our webinar is concluded. Now you may please leave the meeting.